Okay, so I'll let you introduce yourself.
Okay, well, I've been an alt media guy since 1985 when I started writing for the New American Magazine, and you know, that was for the John Birch Society, and one of the first magazines would call the American government, reference the term conspiracy, being behind it, expose the Fed and globalism and so forth. In the mid-90s, I got involved with the creation evolution debate, wrote a couple of books on that. I also wrote a book in 1988 called The Shadows of Power, which is an expose of the Council on Foreign Relations, which is the nexus between the oligarchy that runs America and the government. They provide the cabinet-level personnel, and they've been pushing for world government ever since they were founded in 1921. And then after 9/11, I kind of re-entered the world of geopolitics, and my latest book is called Truth is a Lonely Warrior, which is it's an A to Z primer on the New World Order, everything from false flags and the Fed to vaccines and weather control, and it's all documented, and that's something to give to your friends who are skeptics. I also wrote the script for Shattering, which is a movie narrated by Kevin Sorbo, a pretty well-known Hollywood actor. We have a lot of alt media people in that, everyone from Adam Kokesh to the late Joyce Riley to Pastor Chuck Baldwin and myself. And that's an expose, includes false flags, media control, government control, and the Fed. And my website is jamesperloff.com, which I try to keep up to date with relevant posts. My most recent one, which we'll be discussing today, is called 9/11 Simplified.
Right.
And I'm on Twitter as James Perloff.
Okay, right. So I get regular emails from you, and so I got this email, 9/11 Simplified. So we're just going to basically, you know, interview and just run through your blog.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, hope we don't have any technical difficulties. So it begins, 9/11 Simplified. Yes, Virginia, there really were hijackers on the 9/11 planes, but not the ones that we were told. This post is not intended to be taken dogmatically. I do not insist that its conclusions are correct. They are just presented for consideration, and that's, yeah, I think that's like a good, you know, attitude, I guess, you know, just to sort of open the door for discussion, you know, about things and to, you know, to get people thinking. In this post, though, they have already been much discussed and debated within alternative media. I'll address three major components of 9/11 controversy. Number one, what brought down the Twin Towers? Number two, what initially struck the towers? And three, what happened to the original planes and passengers? I mean, this is just, I mean, the last one is a bit, However, there is a valid complaint often voiced in the truth movement, which runs like this. I really don't care how 9/11 was done, and I'm tired of all the infighting about this. What really matters is we know the government story is bogus, so we need to focus on identifying the criminals and bringing them to justice. I consider this a very legitimate grievance, but I don't think we can separate who from how. When a prosecutor presents his case in a courtroom, he doesn't name a crime's perpetrator without describing how the crime was carried out. Sorry. Nor does he present the jury with the crime's details and methodology without identifying the suspects. So let's tackle both how and who, and we'll start with who because doing so clarifies a lot of the how.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
Yeah, that's you've been reading from the introduction of my post, and that saves me some talking, so thank you. And one of the observations I made was that we have this saying in the truth movement, which is that 9/11 was an inside job. And I think that has led us to some confusion, because what I've concluded is, and at least in proposing, is that 9/11 was basically an outside job.
Hmm.
By the Israelis, but with the cooperation and assistance of high-level Americans such as Dick Cheney. And to take a comparison, to make that a little more understandable, if people are familiar with the attack on USS Liberty in 1967, of course, President Johnson cooperated. He, Defense Secretary McNamara, recalled fighter planes that had been sent to rescue the Liberty twice. But I think we could all agree that at an operational level, it was the Israelis who took out that attack, took on the attack of the Liberty. It was not the U.S. Air Force. And I think we have a similar situation with 9/11, where the operatives were Israelis, but there was cooperation coming from the highest levels of our own government. And what I'd like to do, Kat, is to break this interview down into four basic parts. Number one, what is some of the evidence that Israel was behind this? And then we're going to take those three elements, three basic elements of 9/11, how the towers came down, and what struck the towers before that, and what happened to the planes and passengers. And it's that last one that's probably going to be most controversial, because that's where I'm going to depart from what we might call the mainstream of the alternative media view of what happened to the planes and passengers. So I do believe there actually were hijackers, but just not the ones we were told. So I'd like to start with some of the evidence that Israel was behind this.
James,
you stop me anytime.
I just refer, because right at the beginning you have what's wrong with the following math equation. I just wanted to kind of fit that in just for a bit, because I think that's a good sort of way, 3 plus 3 equals 68, 98 minus 7 equals 2, and 58 times 7 equals 35, and what's wrong with the equations are the number 8s. If you get rid of the 8s, then all the equations, work out, and the 8s are just kind of put in there to throw you, and you're just kind of putting that there to sort of illustrate what's kind of going on.
Right, and I think in this case, the 8 is the idea that it was American operatives who were carrying out the 9/11 attacks, but I do believe they were foreign agents, agents of Israel. And I think when we take that equation, that this was an Israeli false flag at an operational level, it lends a lot of clarity. Again, this is a proposal, it's not something I'm insisting on.
Okay. So...
Let's start with the some of the evidence that Israel was behind this. And in the article, I refer people to a post that I like a lot. It's a WikiSpooks post called 9/11 Israel Did It. And it is concisely, but with comprehensiveness and a lot of graphics, they go character by character and company by company. And so why don't we just talk about some of that. We should certainly start with the dancing Israelis. And it wasn't dancing FBI agents that were caught. We all know that on 9/11, there were these dancing Israelis who were celebrating the attack. They were photographing it. They were high-fiving each other when the towers collapsed. They were even picturing themselves doing selfies, holding up a flickering lighter against the backdrop of the burning towers. Now, a neighbor wrote down their license plate when they drove off in their van, and they were arrested. And after a couple of months, they were sent back to Israel, even though two of them were Mossad agents. At least two were known to be identified Mossad agents. And one of the ironies is, and this is continuation of Israeli involvement, the man of the Justice Department who was put in charge of investigating 9/11 was Michael Chertoff, whose mother was an Israeli citizen and a Mossad agent. So why would you want people connected with Mossad running your investigation here in America? Is it any surprise that he sent home all the arrested Israelis? Well, along with that, we might take, of course, Larry Silverstein. Larry Silverstein was the brand new owner of the World Trade Center. And he, of course, had bought it his partners less than 2 months before 9/11. He invested $124 million, and he got an insurance payout of almost $5 billion. Plus, lucky Larry managed to be gone from the World Trade Center on the morning of the attacks due to a fortuitous doctor's appointment. But what a lot of people don't know is that he was in regular touch with Benjamin Netanyahu. And in fact, he was in such close touch that the Israeli newspaper Haaretz reported this in November 2001. Quote, every Sunday afternoon New York time, Netanyahu would call Silverstein. It made no difference what the subject was or where Netanyahu was. He would always call. And of course, it was Silverstein now in charge of the World Trade Center. It means he has the ability to give Israeli agents access to the World Trade Center. for any setup and preparation they wanted to do. But let's go through some of the other Israeli connections. In the World Trade Center was one major Israeli firm, Zim Navigational, supported by the Israeli government. They decided to move out of the World Trade Center less than 2 weeks before the attacks. You could call that a coincidence, but how many coincidences can there be? World Trade Center security was in the hand of Kroll Associates, which was run by Zionists. The airport security at all the involved airports was run by the same company, a subsidiary of ICTS International, which is owned by Ezra Harel and Menachem Atzum, both Israeli Jews. Then you've got a lot of Zionists and the Bush cabinet. You've got Richard Perle as head of the Defense Policy Board. He'd been caught spying for Israel by the NSA, but he was not punished. And in the Bush's Defense Department. Plus, of course, we all know about Dov Zakheim and Paul Wolfowitz. Paul Wolfowitz used to live in Israel. They were part of PNAC, which called for this new Pearl Harbor to take place to enhance our involvement in the Middle East. You've got employees of Odigo, an Israeli firm, receiving warnings not to be in the World Trade Center just 2 hours before the attack. You've got PTEC, a software firm linked to the Mossad, which is supplying software for the FAA, the FBI, and the armed forces on the morning of 9/11. But the one person I'd like to particularly call attention to is Danny Lewin. Now, Danny Lewin was on Flight 11 on the morning of 9/11, and he was a former captain of the IDF, the Israeli Armed Forces. Plus, most significantly, he was in their Sayeret Matkal, which is their elite special ops. And, you know, you could call this a coincidence, except that Danny Lewin had an official portrait taken in the year 2000, the year before the attacks. And in this official portrait, he's sitting on a bench before two panels that look like the Twin Towers, and he's wearing a watch, and it's a Swatch watch, and the model is Hijacker. That was the actual name of the watch, the Hijacker model watch. And on that watch, if you blow it up, the second hand, minute hand, and hour hand were all set to the 11th, and the date was set to the 11th, even though the picture was not taken on the 11th. Now, the odds against all four time indicators being on the 11th by chance would be over 20,000 to 1. Multiply that times the odds of it being called Hijacker. And then on 9/11, he was in row 9 of flight 11 on 9/11. That's Danny Lewin. And now that's about 5% of the Israeli connections. If you go to that article, which I linked you from my recent blog post, you'll see the other 95%. But that's the beginning of the Israeli connections. And I also want to say one more thing, Kat, before I stop talking about Israelis, which is when police are investigating a crime, one of the first questions they ask is who profited from the crime, you know? Right. If somebody got murdered and there's $1 million insurance payoff, they'll be looking at the person who got that $1 million insurance payoff as a possible suspect. And who profited from 9/11? Did Middle East Muslims profit? No. We've been making war on the Middle East ever since. They've been turned into chaos. We've made hundreds of thousands of people dead, millions into refugees, so they haven't benefited. Now, did America benefit from 9/11? No. We've turned into a police state or semi-police state, and we spent trillions of dollars on these Middle Eastern wars. The only real beneficiary was Israel. They've sat back and watched us bump off their enemies one by one. Afghanistan, Iraq, Libya, we've destabilized Egypt, now we're in Syria, Iran's next on the hit list, and I'm sure you're familiar with that list given by General Wesley Clark, how in 2001 there was already a plan to take out seven countries in the Middle East. So the beneficiary, chief beneficiary is Israel, not to deny that the police state here in America, the deep state, benefited. But that's kind of my brief summary of the Israeli connection. Again, I linked to the article on WikiSpooks from my recent post, 9/11 Simplified. But is there anything you care to add, comment, question?
I mean, not at this point, really. I mean, yeah, I see the guy Danny Lewin, former captain of the IDF, who served in the Sayeret Matkal, counterterrorism assassination.
Oh, I should mention something about him, because this plays into what we're going to be saying today, which is that Danny Lewin, according to mainstream media, could, quote, bench press 315 pounds and was trained to kill terrorists with a pen or a credit card or just his bare hands, unquote. So he was a person capable of killing quite quickly.
Okay. How were the Twin Towers destroyed?
Okay. Now, this is one of those most contentious and controversial topics on 9/11. And I'd like to acknowledge that I have friends in all the camps. You know, one camp, of course, is nanothermite, which is strongly advocated by architects and engineers for 9/11 truth. And you also have Dr. Judy Wood, who proposes directed energy weapons. And again, I have friends in both groups, and it doesn't get in the way of our friendship. And so I happen to be in the third major camp, which is the nuclear camp, and which is also the one the Israelis would be best able to implement, I might add. So what I do in the article, you know, I have an earlier post I've written that's called To 9/11 and Beyond, and it talks at length about the nuclear dimensions of 9/11 and Israel's whole obsession with nuclear weapons. In fact, in 1948, Israel was founded. In 1949, they'd already begun their nuclear weapons program. This has been a long-term obsession for them. But as far as the Twin Towers go, for this particular post, I broke it down to what I call the top 10 reasons why I believe that the World Tower destruction, the tower's destruction was a nuclear event. Number one, we all know that first responders are getting lots of cancer. And the type of cancer they get, in contrast to its expected rate, more than any other cancer is thyroid cancer. Now, why is that significant? Because thyroid cancer is a signature of a nuclear bomb. The only known environmental cause of thyroid cancer is a nuclear weapon. And this is because nuclear weapons give off something called iodine-131, which embeds in the thyroid. This is why some people keep on hand a potassium iodide tablet to protect your thyroid in the case of a nuclear attack. So that's signature number one of an atomic bomb, the high rate of thyroid cancer in first responders. Number two is the U.S. Geological Survey did a study of the dust samples of the World Trade Center, and they found in those samples inexplicably high concentrations of nuclear fission products. We're talking about uranium, strontium, thorium, beryllium, barium, cadmium, and correlations that could only come from a nuclear event. And this was vetted by an author named William Tahoe in his book called The Nuclear Destruction of the Twin Towers, which, as you pointed out to me, the first of the called to my attention, that book, that internet book, had been scrubbed from the internet since I posted this article. You were the one who called my attention that it now says that the account has been suspended, so people can't even reference that book now. But there are other sources. I know Jim Fetzer and others have looked at these nuclear samples, so the data is not gone. But that's reason number two, the nuclear fission products in the dust samples, which can't be explained by anything other than a nuclear bomb. And number three, the cat, you know, they had all this molten steel underneath the World Trade Center, and they had fires that lasted for over 3 months. And high heat is a signature of an atomic bomb. A nuclear bomb actually reaches, at the very center of the nuclear explosion, actually reaches millions of degrees. And so heat is reason number three, why I believe this was a nuclear event. Number four is the explosive force. When the Twin Towers exploded, there were chunks of the World Trade Center that flew hundreds of feet. There was a chunk weighing multiple tons that embedded itself in the American Express building across the street. And there were chunks weighing multiple tons that flew 600 feet and knocked over the Winter Garden atrium. Now, this requires tremendous force. It can't just come from a building collapse. And what is the most powerful explosive known to man? It's an atomic bomb. So it could explain the force required to throw these heavy steel chunks of the World Trade Center. Number five, the insides of the World Trade Center were vaporized. All the people were vaporized. All the furniture was vaporized. All the computers were vaporized. Out of 10,000 filing cabinets, only one survived from the basement. Now, a nuclear explosion could account for this because, unlike a stick of dynamite which just goes boom and its explosion is over, a nuclear bomb explodes and it keeps on exploding. It keeps on applying its energy to its target. So a nuclear bomb could account for the vaporization of the insides of the World Trade Center. And by the way, stop me any time. And I should also mention, by the way, I've done previous shows on this, and I know this is redundant. If people have seen me do another show, this is repetitive, so I apologize for that. But I feel for a new audience, it needs to be repeated. Number six, Kat, is there were seismograph readings that were taken 20 miles north of the World Trade Center at the Lamont-Doherty Earth Observatory of Columbia University at Palisades, New York. And what they show, Kat, is at the so-called plane strikes, they show a blip on the seismograph, but when the towers, quote-unquote, collapse, there's this off-the-chart spike on the seismographs. And the only way to really account for that is a huge explosion, and that would be consistent with a nuclear weapon. And number seven is an area that takes a little bit of explaining and is brand new to a lot of folks, but it helps shed a lot of light on 9/11. We know that at the World Trade Center, there was fire and cratering out of other buildings of the World Trade Center. Building 7 did catch extensive fire. Building 5 had a huge fire, had to be put out by the New York City Fire Department. Building 6 was totally cratered out. And you look at these other buildings that caught fire, that were cratered out. And so when did this happen? And Kat, do you think that it could have happened before the World Trade Center Twin Towers collapsed? I mean, obviously not. Because if Building 7 had caught fire first, before the World Trade Center collapsed, the news cameras would have panned down to Building 7 and said, gee, we seem to have another building on fire here. Here's what people need to know in explaining this damage to the rest of the World Trade Center. Unbeknownst to most people, and this is covered extensively in my post called to 9/11 and Beyond, underneath the World Trade Center, the entire center was interconnected underground by a floodwater drainage system. And the theory I've reached in consultation with people who are experts on nuclear weapons is the Israelis lodged two suitcase nukes in the Twin Towers, one each at the bottom of Elevator 50. Elevator 50 was the only elevator that ran the full length of either tower. And it's the only elevator which had its service pits carved into the bedrock underneath the World Trade Center. This made it the ideal launching pad for a nuke because the bedrock would contain the outward and downward force of the nuke, and then the explosion would follow the path of least resistance up through Elevator 50. So it hit the top of that airplane strike zone very quickly and then spread out underneath. But what people also need to know is that the service pits of Elevator 50 are also where the greatest flooding concern was. So they had sump pits down there, which connected to this underground water drainage system. And what we believe is that all these other buildings were damaged by the secondary force of the nukes traveling underground. And you can see evidence for this. I've got, and 9/11 and Beyond, I've got a picture, and I've got the full clip. You can see that geysers were bursting as the first tower collapsed. You can see outside of the tower, there are geysers bursting out from underground. And this is from this underground pipe. First you see it as steam, then it becomes smoke. And this is why Barry Jennings, who was in Building 7, said that, this is a very famous testimony, he and a colleague were descending Building 7, and the stairwell blew out from underneath them. The explosion was on the bottom up. And they had to retreat upstairs. They were eventually rescued by the New York City Fire Department, but they said there was a tremendous heat in Building 7. And this is where it would come from. It's this secondary force coming through these underground pipes. Building 7 was the furthest building in the World Trade Center from the Twin Towers. Now, some people have suggested that these other buildings were damaged by bombs, but if the terrorists were so successful in collapsing the Twin Towers, why would they fail to collapse the other buildings? And of course, Building 7 itself, no doubt, was around 5 p.m. that day, collapsed with standard controlled demolition. Nobody would dispute that. But already that morning, it was burning. And we're talking about the burning, the fires that were taking place. You can also see evidence from this in a clip I've got. It's a people retreating from the World Trade Center dust cloud.
Yeah.
The cloud is behind them, but in front of them, you can see smoke pouring out of the New York City sewers. This is because this drainage system ultimately dumped into the New York City sewers. And that also, by the way, is the probable explanation of these, we call the burned out cars on the side streets.
Do you want me to play the video?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've got a video of it, and you can see it right in either post. The 9/11 Simplified, you just click on it, and it'll show people as they run from the cloud in front of them. You can see smoke billowing out from the New York City sewage system, and we believe this is secondary smoke from this underground explosion at the World Trade Center. By the way, one reason you know that this is correct is that some people have said that Building 7 caught fire from debris. That can't be. Barry Jennings said the explosion was from the bottom up, and you'll notice that other buildings outside the World Trade Center were hit by debris, such as the American Express building. They didn't catch fire because they weren't connected to the underground system of the World Trade Center. That's my reason number 7 why I think it was a nuke.
So I'll play the video. It's pretty short of the dust cloud.
You can, if you'd like. You can do that later, or are you going to do it now?
Yeah, I'll do it now.
Oh, okay. I didn't know that you could actually tap into that.
Yeah.
We're going to show you some videotape now that I think if you have youngsters around, you might want to pay special attention to it, because the portrayal of the violence is extremely graphic. So take a look. Tell you that there were some portions of that that contained some violence that we thought we should not show on television.
Yeah, I don't know what violence he's referring to, but right, you could see where the tower is coming down, and of course it's just like this huge smoke that's kind of like chasing them down the street, and then as soon as the camera guy turns, it's like in front of them too.
Right, it's in front of them, and it's actually, by the way, Kat, I didn't know you had the ability to show video on your podcast. This is the first time we've done a video cast. We've done only the audio prior to this, you and I. But that clip actually brings me to point number 8. The dust cloud itself is a signature of an atomic bomb. And I know that when a building collapses, you'll get a dust cloud, but usually people can stand off in the distance and be safe from it. These dust clouds on 9/11 seem to have a life of their own. And they were hot. These dust clouds, I've talked to people who were caught in that dust cloud and said how hot it was. And if you look at, just look on YouTube for tests of nuclear bombs by the U.S. military, and you'll see that it doesn't just create a mushroom cloud in the air. At the top, at the ground level, it creates a dust cloud. And I believe this is reason number 8 why I give for why I believe this is a nuclear event. Reason number 9 is Susan Lindauer. Now, Susan was a CIA asset, and she was the second cousin of Andrew Card, who was George W. Bush's chief of staff. And according to Susan, the CIA had forewarnings of 9/11. It was going to involve the World Trade Center, and she thought it was so important, she tried to warn the Justice Department, and she tried to warn Andrew Card. She even stayed outside his home all night, sitting in her car, hoping to reach him, but he didn't come home that night. And she's been a whistleblower. She blew the whistle on our foreknowledge of 9/11, as well as the fact that we knew that Saddam Hussein had the weapons of mass destruction. For all the trouble, she was thrown in federal prison. She's out now. She's got her own radio show. But she, according to her information, the CIA, its advanced info on 9/11 included the destruction of the World Trade Center by a mini nuke. So they had that information that the Twin Towers would be destroyed by a mini nuke. This we're saying here, there's two of them. Reason number 10 is from Benjamin Netanyahu. And I'm going to quote what Netanyahu said in his 1995 book, Fighting Terrorism. Quote, such groups nullify the need to have air power or intercontinental missiles as delivery systems for an Islamic nuclear payload. They will be the delivery system. In the worst of such scenarios, the consequences could be not a car bomb, but a nuclear bomb in the basement of the World Trade Center, unquote. Benjamin Netanyahu, that's on page 125 of that book, Fighting Terrorism. And by the way, he underscored the word, he italicized the word nuclear. He was really getting that across. Now, in my post, I also have a clip of Netanyahu talking to Tom Brokaw 2 days after 9/11, where he refers to this nuclear bomb in the World Trade Center again. Now, you could play that clip visually. I have the audio of it. Shall I play the audio?
Yeah, I got the video right here.
Do you want to play it, or shall I play it?
Yeah.
In 1995, I wrote a book called Fighting Terrorism, and I said that if we don't arrest the tide of Islamic militant terrorism, militant Islamic terrorism, then the next thing that will be is not a car bomb in the World Trade Center, but a nuclear bomb. Now, it wasn't a nuclear bomb. It was a 350-ton conventional bomb.
Okay, so... what's interesting about this is that Netanyahu is, I think he's boasting a little bit about the fact there's a nuclear bomb in the World Trade Center. He corrects himself, perhaps realizing he said too much, and he says it wasn't a nuclear bomb, it was a conventional bomb. But here's the thing, Kat, is how does he know it's a bomb at all? Because the American people are being told it's the airplane strikes alone that have brought the Twin Towers down. And here Netanyahu is saying flat out it was a bomb.
Yeah.
And Tom Brokaw doesn't even question that during the interview.
And this, he's really pushing, Muslims and the Middle Eastern people
start fighting the Muslims, yeah.
As the terrorists. But, right, of course, what Israel is doing, to Palestine is that the plan? For Israel wants to do what they're doing to the Palestinians and in Gaza to, the rest of the Middle East, like Afghanistan and Iran and all that? Is that...
I should have mentioned this, actually, when I talked about Israel being the beneficiary. Israel, which is really, you could call it a Rothschild proxy state, the Balfour Declaration, by which Britain promised to create a Jewish homeland in Palestine, and it was issued specifically to Lord Walter Rothschild. And the Rothschilds had a long vested interest there in Israel. But going back to the original Zionist plan of Theodor Herzl, that goes back to 1897, they envisioned what they called Greater Israel, Israel from the Nile to the Euphrates. And if you look at the Israeli flag, it's got the two blue stripes. That's the Nile to the Euphrates. That's what they want to expand to. They have a plan of aggression. It was outlined in the 1980s. It was called the Yinon Plan. And the best article that summarizes this is on Global Research. It's just look under Global Research for Greater Israel. You'll see this whole plan. And we're actually helping them do it. We're taking out their enemies, destabilizing and dividing, carving up their enemies in preparation for this Greater Israel project.
And so the whole point of completely vaporizing the World Trade Centers and was to just get rid of any kind of evidence.
I think it was beyond that. It was to drive home along with the Pentagon attack, and I think 93 was intended to hit the White House, was to ramp up Americans for war. But there are people, I recently did a show with Freeman, it's called Freeman TV, and he gets into the spiritual significance of the Twin Towers. I mean, they were forming a big 11, and one of the architects of the 9/11, one of the architects of the World Trade Center, original architect, said that one tower was to represent Nelson Rockefeller, the other David Rockefeller. There is a satanic element to this as well.
Oh.
You know, you've heard of burnt offerings, satanic sacrifices. You know, they have a mock burnt offering at the Bohemian Grove in front of a giant aisle. The old days used to have a burn people to death on an altar to Moloch, the evil god. And this was kind of they say that Satanists believe that they draw power from burning human beings, and this is like a gigantic sacrifice. Now, this gets into the whole spiritual significance of 9/11, but that's beyond what I'm trying to do today. I'm just trying to talk about the technicalities of it. Right. But there is more than just motivating us to war. There was, this was a cardinal event, a Luciferian event, as well as a geopolitical event.
And also what they built in place of the World Trade Center, that that white... I don't even really kind of know how to describe it, but it looks somewhat skeletal, almost like some kind of a gigantic rib cage. people have also described that as some kind of symbol of satanic Mason, Freemasonry, or I have to look it up. The wonderful, that white structure that they built in place of, right next to the Freedom Tower that's there now.
Right. It's not fresh in my mind either, but I know that there are significant numbers, 666, related to the height of the towers, etc., the new tower. There is a symbology for sure in the rebuilt World Trade Center.
I could try to see if I could just look it up. Let me see. Freedom Tower structure. I'm just going to, satanic. Oops, am I spelling it? Sorry. And just, see what I get. I mean, I'm not, so much about the building itself, the Freedom Tower, but more that white skeletal. I mean, you get a few things about it. The devil made them do it. One World Trade Center conspiracy, Illuminati. There are definitely things on Freedom Tower structure. I put in Freedom Tower structure satanic, and
collection of search terms. Shall we keep going though?
Sure.
Just to keep the momentum of the show.
Right. I just wanted to encourage people to look it up. Okay.
Absolutely, yeah. There's added dimensions, and I understand that there was already a plan to build this new single tower before the 9/11 event occurred. I've been told that anyway. I haven't vetted it.
Okay, so the next, still about the nuclear hypothesis, Geiger counter readings.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we should mention this. A lot of the... the chief objection to the nuclear hypothesis, people say, where are the Geiger counter readings? There is some limited evidence that there were positive Geiger counter readings, but what people need to understand is that not all nuclear bombs give off a lot of radiation. The Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombs definitely did. There were incredible burnings of people. But during the Cold War, we started to develop tactical nuclear weapons, battlefield nukes. And nuclear weapons ordinarily involve combination of fusion and fission. Now, fission is the breaking apart of atomic particles. Fusion is the fusing together. If you have a bomb with a lot of fission, it will give off a lot of radiation. But if it's very high in fusion percentage-wise, it'll give off limited radiation. Now, obviously, in a battlefield situation, if you use a nuclear weapon, you want a low radiation weapon. There's another name for them is MRR, minimal residual radiation weapons. You don't want radiation destroying your own army. So you want a tactical nuke. And so what kind of nukes do you think Israel stockpiles? Now, we don't know. They don't even admit they've got nukes, but we know from whistleblowers like Mordecai Benunu that they have hundreds of them. And what kind would they stockpile? Well, even though that's a state secret, it's pretty obvious that Israel would want a lot of low radiation nukes, because if it gets into a war with its neighbors, it doesn't want radiation blowing back to Jerusalem and Tel Aviv. So the type of suitcase nukes they would have used on 9/11, which could have been very quickly placed, they're small enough to carry in a backpack, would be low radiation bombs. But there's several other reasons why you wouldn't have a lot of radiation after 9/11. One is that it rained for the next 4 days, even though 9/11 was a bright and sunny day. Another reason is that if you explode a nuclear bomb in a shaft, and the U.S. military has done this testing, it reduces radiation by about 90%. And we're talking about the World Trade Center had 6 basement levels. We're talking about the service pits underneath Elevator 50 in the bedrock. So it was exploded in a shaft. That would reduce radiation. In addition to that, was all that dirt that Giuliani piled on. And also Hurricane Aaron, which is discussed sometimes in connection with 9/11. Hurricane Aaron was one of the strangest hurricanes in history. It started in the Caribbean. It went on a beeline headed for New York City for several days. And on 9/11 was offshore. And then after 9/11, it pulled a U-ey, it hooked a turn, and went up to Greenland. And Dr. Judy Wood has interpreted that as the source of energy for the directed energy weapons. But another possible explanation is a hurricane having very low pressure will pull the atmosphere for the neighboring region, which has higher pressure, into it. And so it would pull a lot of the radiation away from New York City because, you know, the Israelis on 9/11, they're not looking to kill their friends at Goldman Sachs and the Council on Foreign Relations. They're just trying to create an event that's going to stir us into war. So there's several reasons why you would not have high Geiger counter readings, but the most important one I would stress is that they're using a low radiation nuke on that day.
Unbelievable. I mean, the public has no idea what the powers that shouldn't be are doing behind the scenes.
In every field of endeavor, right?
You know, and the fact that so many people don't question 9/11, don't think it was an inside job or an outside job, or they don't want to believe that their government would do these things. I mean, that makes it even that much more challenging to get people to just look at facts and evidence. And I mean, to think that the system, the government is working for their best interest every day is very naive.
They're working for somebody's interest. It's not the people's, that's for sure. They're working for the 1%.
Yeah, I mean, I would think that would be pretty common knowledge by now. I mean, I know that the approval rating of the government is at a pretty low place in history at this point. But I know that there are still people out there that wouldn't, they just can't believe that the government or corporations or whoever is in power, government Sachs or government Wall Street or whatever, would do these things. But the reality, and I just, because we're talking so much about physics, the reality is physics. I mean, if they can do it, if they have the ability and the leverage to do it, they're going to, because there's absolutely nothing impeding them. The public sure isn't impeding them. Just like the World Trade Center is coming down at free fall speed with, nothing was literally impeding them. That's exactly what's happening to the rights of the people, because the people aren't impeding the people in power. So what do you think is going to happen?
Well, it's interesting. David Deese, who's probably the best truther artist out there, has a picture of the World Trade Center, and it's he turns them into the Bill of Rights and shows how the Bill of Rights collapsed.
Exactly.
Exactly. Just as you were saying.
And the rights of the people are being just taken out. Like before people even get any momentum. Like a lot of people don't even have any chance at life. I mean, there's so many examples aside from 9/11 that prove that I mean, it's just I can't even believe that we even have to question it, because it's so obvious the people have been sold out to corporate profit. I mean, who doesn't know that by now? I don't know.
Right. We have to be totally living in the blue pill matrix and have your head stuck in the mainstream media. And until you get out of that matrix, you don't have a chance of understanding the truth. You have to. One reason why people can't accept what we're saying about 9/11, and I'm not talking about my views specifically, but just does 9/11 not be what the government told us, is they don't know the history of false flags, and that our government has repeatedly lied to us.
Exactly.
Okay, so what I thought we'd do now, Kat, is move on to the third area, which is what hit the towers, and this may bring us to the break. What I explained in the article is that when I first heard the no planes theory, I said, oh my word, going back a few years, I said, oh my word, people are buying cognitive dissonance. This is going to make the whole truth movement look ridiculous. Thousands of people saw that second plane hit the South Tower, and I just said, this is just nonsense, right? But then I started looking more seriously at this, because some people I respected were talking about no planes. And I started looking, and I looked at Shanksville, and all you've got at Shanksville is a smoking little hole, and we're supposed to believe a plane went into that. And you compare it to the wreckage of other planes, and you see the bodies and the wreckage. And Shanksville, just to quote the Somerset County Coroner, Wallace Miller, he said, quote, this crash was different. There was no wreckage, no bodies, unquote. He said he didn't see a single drop of blood in that hole at Shanksville. And that's pretty significant, you know. And then you look at the Pentagon, I'm going to give you a quote. This is from Lieutenant Colonel Karen Katowski, PhD, U.S. Air Force, retired. Quote, there was a dearth of visible debris on the relatively unmarked Pentagon lawn where I stood only minutes after the impact. Beyond this strange absence of airliner debris, there was no sign of the kind of damage to the Pentagon structure one would expect from the impact of a large airliner. This visible evidence or lack thereof may also have been apparent to the Secretary of Defense, Donald Rumsfeld, who, in an unfortunate slip of the tongue, referred to the aircraft that slammed into the Pentagon as a missile, unquote, Lieutenant Colonel Katowski. Now, in my post, I also have a clip, embedded clip of April Gallup. She's one of the most outspoken critics of the Pentagon plane explanation. She was in the Pentagon. She and her colleagues walked out to that very hole that was created. They saw no signs of a plane, no airplane parts, no bodies, no luggage, no seat cushions, nothing. Then we have the fact that the Pentagon has been able to produce even one single decent photograph of the approaching airliner. With all those security cams, all they can give us is one little picture taken from a driveway camera that catches a flash of something going by, and that's all they've got. That's all they've got for the Pentagon attack. And then the just the physics of whatever hit the Pentagon, it blew through three layers of this reinforced concrete, creating a gigantic hole right through to the end of the third layer. And how does an aluminum airplane do that? Plus the impossible descent of the plane. Aircraft pilots have said that you can take a jet airplane and pull it out of a dive like that, but if a jetliner, a commercial airliner, is a steep descent, it's going to crash. You can't pull it out of that deep, steep descent. And yet we're supposed to believe that this unskilled Arab pilot flew this plane parallel to the ground without scuffing it and smashing to the first floor of the Pentagon.
Even Sully wouldn't have been able to do that.
Major General Albert Stubblebine, and I've got a clip from him, and he's got plenty of clips on YouTube. He was a former head of Army intelligence, and he said, looks like a missile. And he said, if a plane hit the Pentagon, why did the titanium engines smash the Pentagon and cause damage? I mean, it's clear it was not a jetliner. So after hearing this evidence against a plane at the Pentagon and Shanksville, that's when I started to take the no planes at the World Trade Center and start looking at that critically.
But even Rumsfeld slipped and said it was a missile.
Right.
There's probably no video of that on.
I think there is.
Oh,
I
is
think
there?
That you can. There is.
Oh, good.
There are a few slips that were made over time. They correct themselves, but then they they make the error before they can correct it.
And wasn't,
all right, so let's... Oh, I'm sorry.
Wasn't he the one who told the military to stand down on the day of 9/11?
That may have been Cheney. Who put himself in command of everything that day. You know, they had Bush out of the way, of course. Bush was down reading at an elementary school, reading a story about a pet goat, which they thought was his speed. It's interesting, I was on Freeman TV, he says he does not believe it's a coincidence about a goat. As you know, goats fit very heavily into satanic symbology. You know, Marina Abramovic, she was in that spirit cooking thing that John Podesta was involved with. She has herself posing with a cut off head of a goat. So it may not be a coincidence that the story was about a goat. And if you actually listen to the children, as Bush already knows that the second tower has been hit, he hears them doing a spelling lesson, and the words they repeat are plane must hit steel kite. Those are the words. Plane must hit steel kite.
In a book about a goat?
This is after the goat. Bush is listening to a spelling lesson. If you listen to the full tape. That's not the exact word of the words, but those are the words that they said. Plane must hit steel goat. And that's after reading the story about the pet goat. So, read into that what you will, but again, a lot of coincidences with some spiritual value that, potential spiritual value.
Yeah, just because people don't want to believe that darkness exists doesn't believe it doesn't.
Doesn't mean it doesn't, that's right. Let's talk then about the Twin Towers. Is it possible that planes did not hit it? And I'm going to say it is possible. Because if you look at Flight 175, we immediately see, which is the second plane hitting the South Tower, this is the one that there's so many film clips of, we see two impossibilities. Number one, the plane was traveling at 590 miles per hour. Now, the max operating speed of a Boeing 767 is 424 miles per hour. It could certainly fly over 500 at altitude, but if you bring it down to ground level, the air is much thicker. It's going to run into so much resistance, it is uncontrollable. And I've got an embedded clip there from in my article from Pilots for 9/11 Truth. You can see it on YouTube. It's called Airplane Controllability. And what they did was they talk about the uncontrollability at 590 miles per hour, but they also have several pilots. They attempted to recreate the hitting the Twin Towers, and these are experienced Boeing pilots who have thousands of hours of flying time on Boeing. None of them could hit the Twin Towers at the alleged speed. So how does a hijacker do it? And here's a very important point to bear in mind, Kat, which is that everything had to happen like clockwork and perfectly on 9/11. Imagine for a moment that Flight 175, that plane didn't make a bullseye hit. Both planes made bullseyes. If the second plane had only clipped the South Tower with its wing, they never would have been able to collapse the tower. It had to be guaranteed in advance that both planes were going to make bullseyes or they could have not collapsed the towers as they did. Mm. So how could they arrange that? There's no way that you could guarantee an airplane that 590 mph can do that. That's the first proof against the plane hitting the second tower. The second one is the impossible physics that you look at. This is what they call the Wile E. Coyote imprint. You know, when Wile E. Coyote and the old Looney Tunes, he'd go through a rock and you'd see his image. So on Flight 175, it flies into the tower on the images, and its aluminum wings and its aluminum tail don't break off. They just fly through the tower, the 14-inch steel columns,
right,
as if they're butter. And that can't happen. They would have broken off.
Right, the wings go and cut the tower.
Right. And I've got another clip in the post where you see a real plane crash, and a plane flies through telephone poles, and it doesn't knock over the poles. The poles tear off the wings of the plane. These are wooden poles, not concrete. Steel.
Steel building.
So there's no way that these fragile wings and tail could fly through into the tower. And so... I'm not sure exactly what did hit the tower, but I have a couple proposals in the article. And now some people have said that these images we look at were CGI, computer-generated graphics created after the fact. But This has been disproven by a pretty good 9/11 researcher named Richard Hall. He took the 26 best videos of what Flight 175 hitting the tower, and he created a scale model of New York City on his computer, and he plotted based on the position of the cameras, and he found that all 26, the object followed the exact same trajectory, which proved that something real really did hit the towers. But what was it? And the theory that I'm working on is that it may have been a cloaked missile. A missile resolves a lot of the issues that a plane has. A missile has precise guidance. In fact, let me give you a little quote from the Navy on cruise missiles. The Tomahawk Block II variant uses an inertial navigation system aided by terrain contour matching for missile navigation. It adds digital scene matching and global positioning satellite system guidance capability coupled to the existing Block II guidance systems for precision navigation. The Block IV missile with its onboard camera provides battle damage information to warfighting commanders. It can loiter over a target area to respond to emerging targets, and has a precision navigation weapon system such as become the weapon of choice for the U.S. Department of Defense, unquote. The point being that a missile could be precisely guided, unlike a plane, which has all these what they call G-forces, which are against its wings, making it very difficult to control.
How different is a missile from a drone?
We'll talk about that.
Could it have been a drone, or is that like far, far different than what a missile?
Well, another advantage of a missile in comparison to a plane is that a plane's nose is hardened for penetration. This resolves the penetration problem. It can fly through steel. It does, a cruise missile. Unlike a airplane's nose, which is soft and which gets smashed in by bird strikes. I've got a picture there, because you see many pictures on the internet. Just Google bird plane strikes airliner nose, and you see all kinds of smashed in airplane noses from bird strikes.
What kind of birds are those? I mean, geese? They must be like geese.
Sometimes they're small birds. That have done this. Sometimes it's a single bird. But in any event, there's no way that an airliner nose could act as a battering ram going through steel column after steel column on 9/11. But a missile could. A missile could do it. But that brings in the question of how do they cloak it? And I wonder if we should save that for the other side of the break. I think we're coming up pretty close to the end of our time.